A very good afternoon to all the participants. This webinar, today's lecture, which I am going to give today, is focused on discussing the mix design of bituminous mixtures. Now, since I was asked to deliver a lecture on mix design of HMA hot mixers fault as well as warm mixers fault, so I have used a very general topic or a general title of the topic, that is a general overview on mixed design of asphalt mixtures, where I will be discussing about the mixed design of hot mix asphalt, which and also about the mixed design of warm mix asphalt, which in fact is very similar to the mixed design of hot mix asphalt and is a little different in one or two aspects. We will be discussing about the importance of material parameters such as the materials we use, the aggregate gradation, the mix parameters, with some special relevance to performance. So at the end of my presentation, I will also try to discuss, or I will also try to indicate the lacuna which is involved in the current mix design procedures we use in India, and what are the researches which are going on in this domain, especially related to the performance related mix design aspects. With this, let us start the presentation. So, since we will be discussing about the asphalt or bituminous mixture, let us start with its definition. How do you define an asphalt or bituminous mixture? So, in very simple terms, an asphalt mix can be defined as a heated mixture of mineral aggregates uniformly coated and mixed with bitumen or mixed with asphalt. So, I think this is can be a one of the simplest definition of an asphalt mixture. So we have bitumen, we have aggregates which are graded, we have some specific sieve size distribution, and we mix them together, we heat and mix them, and we finally get the asphalt mixture ready for construction. This is what we get. Now, depending on the distribution of the aggregate particles, there can be different types of bituminous mixtures. It can include a dense graded mix. It can include an open graded mix, for example, open graded friction pores or asphalt treated permeable base with a very high air void content of around 18 to 22%. We can also have a gap graded mix with excellent stone to stone contact and with very good resistance as one of the properties. So we have very high coarse aggregate content, very high filler content, and very high binder. Which makes the mix very rich in nature. This graph which you see aside, it shows the distribution of aggregates for different types of mix. Now, the black line which you see here, the straight black line, this is the maximum density line which you get through the Fuller-Thompson curve by using the Fuller-Thompson equation, which says that the percent passing heat sieve can be calculated as d by d to the power of 0.5. Earlier 0.5 was also used. Now, using this formula, you can calculate the, you can draw the maximum density line, the black line, and the target aggregate gradation is basically decided by considering this black line as the indicator line. So this black line is the maximum density line. Now we want sufficient air voids in the mixture, sufficient voids in mineral aggregates. So we move around this line. So this orange line, which you see, is a well-graded structure. It is a gradation of bituminous concrete, which we use in India. The green line, which you see here, is the gradation of stone mastic asphalt. And the blue line, which you see here, is, you can see, is a uniformly graded structure. And this is the open graded friction course. Now, since we will also be discussing about warm mix asphalt, which I wanted to clarify here, that warm mix asphalt is not actually a type of mix. It rather refers to any mix which can be produced at lower temperatures using a variety of technologies while maintaining appropriate workability. So usually the warm mix asphalt can be produced at temperature around 20 to 40 degrees Celsius lower than the conventional hot mix asphalt. And there are various technologies such as we have foam based technology, we have which we also call as water bearing technology. We have wax based technologies, and we also have chemical additives in this area. So what we get in a warm mix asphalt, we get a similar mix just like in hot mix asphalt, but which is produced at a lower temperature. Okay. So what is the final objective of the mix design? Essentially, the objective of the mix design is to find the best possible combination of asphalt binder and aggregate to get long lasting performance. This is our final aim, that we should be able to produce a mix which will give me a satisfactory performance when I lay it in the field. Now, this definition of long lasting performance, when I say that I want long lasting performance, it depends on the desired properties to be achieved. So what are these desired properties and how to quantify them? Will they be same for all the locations? The answer is no. So the desired properties, it depends on the expectation of the project and also the position of the mix within the pavement structure, whether the mix is acting as a binder course, as a base course, or as a surface course. Now, for example, the requirement of a highway pavement is very, very different from a parking lot. So definitely the mix which I'll be producing for a highway will not be same to the mix which I will be preparing for a parking lot, because they both have different functions. Similarly, requirement for a binder course, as I said, is different than that of the surface course. So it is important to design our mixes based on the project requirements. If I place it in other words, we can say that mix design cannot be adopted uniformly for all the conditions. Now, for any mix design to be successful, it is also important, very important, that good construction practices and good quality control in the mixing plant are adopted. And as I said, that depending on the location, for example, we can have a base bituminous course, a binder course, or a surface course. So we need not compromise with the quality of the materials which we are producing for any level, because it will happen that the surface course material will after some time act as a binder course when the pavement is being overlaid. So we don't have to compromise the mix properties at any level we are preparing. This particular slide, the next slide, it shows different cases for which different mix design requirements have to be adopted. For example, the requirement for a high volume road will be different from that of a parking lot, as I just mentioned in the previous slide. Similarly, the requirement of a mix which is placed in a hot climate will be different than that of a location with freezing temperatures. Likewise, the requirement for locations with heavy rainfall can also be different. So, but the question is that do we really consider this in the mix design which we do in the lab? The answer is no. So this indicates that there is a need to change the process we are adopting if we want long lasting performance in the field. Talking about the philosophy of mix design, when we say that the mix has to be designed for achieving some desired properties, what are these properties we are actually looking for? So there are several properties which we want from our mix. We need sufficient binder in the mix to ensure durability. We need sufficient stability in the mix as well as flexibility in the mix to satisfy the need of traffic. We also have to prepare a mix with sufficient air void content. Why we want this sufficient air void content? For secondary compaction to take place after the traffic starts moving on it. And also we want some space for thermal expansion of the binder when the temperature changes. We also have to restrict the maximum void content, maximum permissible void content. Why? Because we want to restrict permeability, which is responsible for aging, for movement of water, for moisture damage, and so on. Again, we also want sufficient workability with the mix. We want that we can easily work with the mix in the mixing plant. We can easily lay the mix at the site and then easily compact it. And also for surface courses, if we see the requirement of surface courses, we also want good skid resistance for safety against hydroplaning in the wet weather condition. Now, all these properties which we have highlighted here, which we demand from the mix, they are at opposite end of the material spectrum, which means that there cannot be a single binder content or a single aggregate gradation which can maximize all these properties. So binder content in the mix is selected to optimize the properties depending on the specific conditions. So for any given condition, first we have to identify the hierarchy of these properties, which properties are more important in our list or our project. Now the properties at the top of our list, which we have prioritized, should be maximized first while keeping all the other properties within the specification limits. Now, before we see the process of mixed design, let us have a quick look at the historical development of the mixed design procedure. Now, this will help us to understand how mixed design has progressed over a period of time. So, as is given in the literature, the first pavement in the US was constructed in 1870 in Newark, New Jersey. Now, this I am telling about the US. This is not the first time asphalt material was used in the pavement. The first recorded use of asphalt is actually very debatable, and it dates back to around 600 BC and even before. Okay. So in 1870, the first pavement in the US was constructed in Newark, New Jersey. Then, following which, in 1908, there was a pavement technologist, Clifford Richardson, who used to work with the Barber Asphalt Company. He paved an innovative product called as the sheet asphalt. So what was sheet asphalt? This was a mixture of the natural bitumen, which came from the Trinidad Lake, and clean angular sand. Then a mixture of these two, he used to pave the pavement. And he realized the importance of the air voids and the voids in mineral aggregates in the mix. In the same period, Frederick Warren of Warren Brothers Company, they started producing large stone mixes. Okay, so they used to produce a very dense mixes just like HMA with large stone sizes, tightly packed with minimum voids. And they used aggregates more than 3 inches. So initially they called their product as bitulithic, and then this bitulithic product was later modified and improved, and they marketed it as in the name of Warren. They also filed a patent for their product, but their patent was subsequently violated, for which they filed a suit in the law. And then the court, it said that in order not to violate the patent rules, anyone can produce a mix with maximum size of aggregate less than 0.5 inches. Now this rule, it led to the development of fine mixes in 1912. Around 1920 to 1950, Hubbard and Field, both were engineers, they developed their own mix design procedures. They developed fine graded mixes, and they also developed stability tests to determine the performance of the mixes. Then around 1930, Francis Heaven, who used to work with the California Department of Highways, he developed the kneading compactor. Now this kneading compactor was developed keeping in mind that they wanted a mix which can replicate the movement of the aggregates just like inside the roller. So this was done to simulate the field compaction, and he also developed equipments against shear deformation, which is Hewitt's stabilometer. Again, during the same period in 1930, on the other side, Bruce Marshall, who was working with the Mississippi Highway Department, he developed impact compaction. Now this impact compaction was developed to represent or to make a mix which will give us the density to be achievable in the field after years of traffic. Now this method became very famous, especially during the World War II, when they required many pavements to be constructed to land the aircraft at remote places. Now since the Marshall equipment was portable, was easy to handle, this method became very, very famous, and it was widely used up to 1990s, especially in the US. Now this is the method which we actually also use in India, but definitely initially the Marshall method was modified to accommodate higher volume of traffic, and that is what the MS2 guidelines outlines, and we use it in the present state. But in US, things progressed. During 1987 to 1993, Federal Highway Administration, they sponsored a very big project, around $150 million, and out of which almost $50 million was used for development of asphalt specifications. Now, this led to the development of PG grading system and also the super pave mix design. So in the US, most of these states are presently using the super pave mix design procedure, and we in India, we are presently using the partial mix design process. So with this overview on the evolution of mix design, now let us proceed further and see the steps which are involved in the mix design procedure. Okay, so before we proceed to the step, so these are two papers if someone is interested to know more about the historical perspective of use of asphalt, you can refer to these two papers which I found to be very interesting. Okay, so this is the flowchart which explains everything we have to do in the mix design. The process starts with testing and selection of the aggregate, aggregate gradation, and appropriate binder. Now, this is followed by preparation of mix using a particular compaction process. For Marshall mix design, for example, we use impact compaction. Once the mix is ready, we do volumetric analysis, which is followed by testing of the mixes. Now, the results from the volumetrics and the testing of mixes are further analyzed, and we finalize the mix design steps. So definitely, if you see here, the chart will look very simple, it's not it. But we have to understand the importance of each step and its relevance to the performance. So in the subsequent slides, we will start discussing about each steps involved in the mix design process, which are highlighted in this particular flowchart. Before we proceed, since we are parallelly discussing about warm mix asphalt also, the mix design of warm mix asphalt follows the same process. Everything remains the same, except this location where mixing and compaction has to be done. This is where WMA differs from HMA. Now, you can, there are several papers, several review papers published on WMA, the mix design procedure, the difference of the mix design procedure of WMA and HMA, and so on. So, this is a recently published paper by our group, which you can refer in construction and building materials, which gives a good overview about different aspects involved in the mix design procedure of warm mix asphalt. Okay. Let us now take each step at a time. So the first step in the process is to test and confirm the materials. Okay. So if we take bitumen, what we will do, if we take the binder, what we will do, we will use some specific guidelines. For example, in India, if we are going for a viscosity graded bitumen, we will use IS 73. If we want to test a polymer modified bitumen, we will use IS 15462. And we perform a set of laboratory experiments to determine their properties. These experiments can include tests like penetration, softening point, ductility, short-term aging using a thin film oven or rolling thin film oven. We can do safety test, viscosity test, and probably if we are using a polymer modified binder, we do some rheological experiments using a dynamic shear. Now, I'm sure that the participants who are here, they already have some basic knowledge about this test, and obviously I'll not be discussing that during the presentation. Now, once we do the experiments, what we will do, we'll check if the binder meets the specified ranges as per the specifications. If it does not, what we will do, we will change the binder. And if it does, if all the criteria are satisfied, then we will use it for the mixed design, which means the binder passes all the criteria. Let us move ahead to the next step. Now, the question is, how important is the testing of binder if we want to relate it to performance? Now, we have to remember that though asphalt binder is used in a very small amount, it occupies only 10 to 15% of the total volume of the mix. However, it is the main component which provides cohesion to the mix and keeps the aggregate particles together. Moreover, because of the presence of bitumen, the asphalt mix derives its viscoelastic nature. If we talk about the cost, roughly 70% of the HMA cost comes from the asphalt binder alone. So definitely, accurate characterization of bitumen properties are mandatory for good performing pavements. If we talk in terms of distresses, bitumen has moderate role in rutting, very high role in fatigue cracking, an extremely high role when it comes to low temperature cracking. Now, of course, this is not a generalized statement. There are other factors influencing the performance too. For example, aggregate particles are responsible to provide the shear strength. The extent of contribution of the aggregates and binder is mix dependent. And obviously, the properties of the mix, the thickness of the different layers, the air voids in the mix, they also play an equally important role in defining the performance of the mix. Now, in India, we use viscosity graded system, which actually cannot quantify the rheological response of this complicated material, that is asphalt binder, having very varying temperature and time conditions. Now, being such an important material influencing the performance, it is time that in the coming future we start adopting more advanced tests to grade the bitumen. For example, we start adopting more advanced rheological experiments to grade the bitumen instead of testing the bitumen at a single temperature and then grading it. Okay, with this, let us now move to the next step. Now, once the properties of the binder has been selected, we have to choose the aggregates, decide the aggregate gradation, and perform blending of stock mix. Okay, so in India, the physical properties of the aggregates are determined based on the guidelines outlined by the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. We have to perform several physical tests such as impact test, loss and generous ablation test, water absorption test, specific gravity, and so on. Other tests are also done which are equally important. For example, we have to carry out stripping value test, sand equivalent test, and so on. Okay. Now, this stripping value test, I find this very, actually, I don't find people readily adopting the stripping value test, but it's a very important test in the lab, especially when we are using siliceous aggregates like granite. So the siliceous aggregates are very prone to moisture damage, and it's always good that in the lab, during the mix design process, we do this quick stripping value test to see if the aggregates are compatible with the binder we are trying to use. Out of all these tests, specific gravity is one of the most important properties, which is directly used in calculations of mix design. All the other properties are pass and fail test. We do the test, we see whether we are within the required specifications or not, and we proceed. But specific gravity is one test, is one value, which is directly used in the calculations involved in the mix design. So it's very important that we correctly estimate the specific gravity and very fundamentally understand the importance of specific gravity. And therefore, you know, in this presentation also, we'll be discussing about the importance and determination of specific gravity in the further slides. Next comes the grading and blending. Now, the gradation, or in common terms, the sieve size distribution of the aggregates, depends on the project requirement. So we have to decide whether we have to use a dense graded mix, whether you have to use a gap graded mix, whether I want to use an open graded mix, or whatever is the case. In India, for example, the binder and wearing course, which we typically use in the construction of highways, we use dense graded mix like dense bituminous macadam. We call it, short form is DBM. I hope everybody has heard about it. And in surface course or wearing course, we use something called bituminous concrete. Now, once the gradation has been finalized, we have to do the blending of different stock. So what happens at the mixing plant? The aggregates, after quarrying and crushing, are stored depending on the aggregate size. You can see they are stored in several different stockpiles. For example, we can have a stockpile of 20 mm passing aggregates, we can have a stockpile of 10 mm passing aggregates, or we can have a stockpile of fine aggregates and fillers. Okay. Now, these stockpiles has their individual gradation and should be mixed in such a proportion that the resulting mix satisfied the desired gradation criteria which we have selected. What do I mean by this? For example, if let us say we have three different stock mix, okay, and they have their own sieve size distribution, which is shown here. They have their own sieve size distribution. Now, by mixing them, we want to get in the gradation limit. What is the gradation limit? This is the lower bound and upper bound limit as specified by the Ministry of. Let us say we are targeting for a bituminous concrete one gradation. So you can see the orange line here, the top line, and the bottom red line with the red marker. So they indicate the upper bound and the lower bound of the gradation, which means A, B, and C should be mixed such that the resulting gradation falls within these two bands. The next question is, in what proportion should I mix A, B, and C to achieve the desired range? Well, there can be many different options. There can be probably thousands of options, lakhs of options. It is also possible that there are no options. In that case, we will change one or two of the stock points. But it is always possible that there are several solutions of mixing A, B, and C to fall within the specified range. The question is that out of these three, suppose let us say we are taking three options here. There can be many, as I said, but let us say, just for example, we get three options which satisfies our upper bound and lower bound criteria. The question is, which out of these three, which is the best? Now, to answer this question, we have to use a concept typically used in the super plate mix design. We can always use it in the Marshall mix design also, which is called as the design aggregate gradation. Okay. Now, why we need a design aggregate gradation? First, let me tell you what is typically done in India. We bring the stockpiles, we sieve them, we mix them using trial and error method. So we keep on changing the percentages of different stockpile, and once we see, okay, let us say that this is the upper bound, this is the lower bound. Once we find that my mix is somewhere in the middle, we become very happier and we stop there. And we say, let us mix it in this proportion. This is coming in this way and it is satisfied. But this can, it can also happen that after completing the mix design, maybe some of the parameters, let us say the voids in mineral aggregates, okay, they does not meet the minimum specified limit. So the mix designer has to redo the entire process. It is also possible that the gradation which the mix designer has selected here, okay, just because it is falling somewhere in the middle, probably this is not the best gradation with optimized material properties. So what design aggregate gradation does, it helps us to solve these issues. It helps us to answer these questions. So typically what we can do, we can take three aggregate gradations which satisfies the criteria of the upper bound and lower bound limit, and we evaluate these three gradation at a single binder, at only one binder. Okay, in the design aggregate gradation, at only one binder content, let us evaluate option one, option two, and option three, and then decide which option is the best. So now let us look at the process of the design aggregate gradation with some examples. As I said, the best way to explain the design aggregate gradation is through an example. Let us say we have three different stockpiles as was shown in the previous slide, A, B, and C. Now the target is to mix A, B, and C such that the resulting mix falls within the specification limit of BC1, bituminous concrete 1. This is, let us say, what we are targeting for, bituminous concrete 1. Now for the given stockpiles, as I had said, while there can be many options, for this particular example, I have taken three options which satisfies the criteria. Okay. And these options are as follows. The first option is taking 30% of A, 40% of B, and 30% of C. So if I mix 30% of A, 40% of B, and 30% of C, I will be able to reach within the gradation. Let us say this is option one. If I take 25% of A, 45% of B, and 30% of C, I still satisfy the upper and lower bound limit. Let us say I use option two. Another option can be, if I use 35% of A, 40% of B, and 25% of C, I get option three, and again I am within the specification. Now, how to decide which one to take for the final mix design, whether I should go with one, two, or three? So what are the steps in? We have to choose first one binder content and make mixes using all the three blending options. Okay. Now the choice of this binder content, which I am going to use in the trial, it can be taken based on experience. For example, in bituminous concrete, the optimum binder content ranges from about 4.5 to 5.5%. So let us say we can take 4.5% as the single binder content at which I'll be evaluating the three options. We will make trial mixes. We'll make trial mixes, three samples per option, and evaluate mix parameters. What are these parameters? We can evaluate parameters like air voids, voids in mineral aggregates, and voids filling in bitumen. At this moment, I'm assuming that the participants are aware of these terminologies, but we are going to introduce these terminologies later in my presentation also. Now let us say I have made four, using 4.5% binder content, I have made mixes with A, B, and C aggregate gradation. Okay, and for all these three mixes which I have made, I am evaluating these parameters. After evaluating these parameters, let us say I get these answers. Okay, so you can see that the trial binder content is 4.5%. The air void is given here. First case 3.8, 4.3, 4.8. This is what I have got after evaluating the mixes. Okay. Similarly, the data of voids in mineral aggregates and voids filled with bitumen are also shown. Now, the next step. What is the next step? The next step is to estimate the binder content corresponding to 4% air void. Now, you see, this sentence is very important and you should not be confused here. First, we have taken a particular binder content and evaluated the volumetric properties for all the three options. Now, what I am doing using this table by doing some calculations, I am trying to estimate the binder content corresponding to 4% air void and recalculate the parameters. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that I am trying to find out that for option one, in order that this air void is equal to 4%, what should be the binder content? Okay, so this is what I am trying to do. Now, to estimate this, there are two assumptions which we have to use. Okay, now you can say that these are thumb rules which are observed for bituminous mixtures. What are those observed assumptions? The first assumption is that 1% reduction in air void will increase the binder content by 0.4%. Okay, so this is first assumption. So if I take this first assumption into consideration, for example, let us say we are seeing the option two. Okay, let us say we are seeing option two. Let me remove this first. Let us say we are seeing option two. Okay, at 4.5% binder content here, we are getting an air void of 4.3%. So to get 4% air void, what does it mean? 0.3% reduction in the air voids from what we have now, the binder content should be how much? It should be four, using this assumption, four, I'm just interpolating 4.5 plus 0.4 into 0.3. It is equal to 4.62%. Okay, or say 4.6%. Similarly, the estimated binder content for other options can also be calculated. Now, the second assumption here is that 1% increase in air voids increases the VMA around 0.1 to 0.2%, let us say 0.2%. Again, if I see an example, let us say option 3, at 4.8% air void, the present VMA is how much? 13.5%. So what would be the VMA at 4% air? If this 4.8% was to be 4%, then what will this value be using this assumption? Again, if we do interpolation, that is 13.5 minus 0.2 into 0.8, this becomes equal to 13.3%. Okay. So likewise, the VMA for other options can also be calculated. Okay. Now, once we have the estimated binder content and VMA, we can also calculate VFB. Voids filled with bitumen is directly related to the air voids and to the VMA using this particular equation. So this can also be calculated. So this is the formula which we have used. Now, using this formula, this particular table which you see now, it presents the final result. Okay, and you will see that in the last column, the specification for each parameter as per Ministry of Road Transport and Highways is mentioned. That for the standard mix design, airborne should be 4%. VMA, which depends on the nominal maximum aggregate size, should be greater than equal to 12%. The range of VMA is 65 to 75%. And now this is the estimated result for option 1, option 2, and option 3 at 4% airborne. You see, 4% airborne. Okay. Now, very interestingly, you see here that all the options satisfies the criteria, which is given in the last column. Okay, which indicates that all the three options can actually be used, and we can use any of them as the final gradation. But what to do now? At this stage, how do we choose any one of them? Okay, so at this stage, we can look at the economics. We can look at the cost. Okay, so you see, option one has the least binder content, 4.4%. You see here, 4.4%, and it also satisfies all the other criteria. So a designer, to save cost, because bitumen is anyway very costly, so to save the cost, he can go with option one and finalize the mix. Okay. Okay. So this shows that how important design aggregate gradation can be. Okay. So design aggregate gradation is an important part to be incorporated into this design, which traditionally we do not do. Why it is important? Because it will help us to choose the best possible gradation for the optimized performance of the mix. And the next question is, what if there are 100 possible combinations? We have taken only 3, you see, but it, as I said, it's possible that there are 100 and 1000 of possible ways of mixing A, B, and C. So here the designer, based on his experience, can take 3 to 4 mixes. Maybe, you know, if this is the band, he can take one mix which is close to the coarser gradation, final gradation, one mix closer to the coarser gradation, and one mix somewhere in the middle. So he can take 3 gradations and then use these 3 gradation as per the design aggregate gradation procedure, and then choose any one of them. Okay. So I hope this part was clear to you. Okay. Now, as I said previously, specific gravity is that particular physical property which is very important for the success of the mix design. So let us start our discussion on specific gravity. Okay. Now, at the aggregate level, there are 3 specific gravities whose definition we should know as a pavement engineer. It is the apparent specific gravity, bulk specific gravity, and effective specific gravity. Now, the formula for determination of specific gravity, irrespective of which specific gravity we are actually calculating, it remains the same, which you can see in the slide. Now, the difference between all the three, and when I say the formula is the same, but there are 3 specific gravities, what does it mean? Where is the change? The change is in the weight in air, in the denominator. Okay. This weight is an indirect representation of the volume we are interested in. This is a representation of the volume we are interested in. Now, if it is an apparent specific gravity, we are interested to find the volume of the solids in the dry state. So let us say that this is the aggregate which is shown here, and these are some of the surface voids in the aggregate, some microscopical voids. In the aggregates. Okay. So if I am calculating the apparent specific gravity, I am interested only in the shaded one. I am not interested in the total volume. I am interested only in the shaded one. In case of bulk specific gravity, I am interested in the bulk volume, including the volume of the water permeable pores. Okay. This is the reason that in the lab we take the saturated surface dry. Now, for the effective specific gravity, the volume which we are interested in is the bulk volume, of the aggregate, V bulk, minus the volume of pores filled with bitumen, minus the absorbed bitumen, okay, minus the volume of the absorbed bitumen. Now, this is actually very difficult to determine in the lab, because we cannot determine the bitumen absorption of the aggregates by measuring it in the air. That is why effective specific gravity is calculated and apparent and bulk specific gravity are measured. Okay. Theoretically, if we say that the bitumen absorption, if the bitumen absorption of the aggregate is zero, then the bulk specific gravity and effective specific gravity will become equivalent, is not it? Also, if the water absorption of the aggregate is zero, then all the specific gravity will become the same. But ideally, definitely, this is not the case. A thumb rule here is that bitumen absorption is approximately 50 to 70% of the water absorption. This is thumb rule we can use. Now we have to remember here that accurate determination of specific gravity, at least up to three significant digits, is very important for the success of an exercise. It is recommended that the specific gravity be measured at least 5 times to observe the repeatability in the lab. We have found large variations in the specific gravity in the lab, specifically for the final. So we have to be very critical about determination of specific gravity because it has direct implications on our final mixed design. Okay. Now the story of specific gravity does not end just by defining the specific gravity. We have to remember few additional important concepts, and I'm sure I have seen that many a times these errors are made in the lab while doing the mixed design, while doing the calculations. So I will explain them using few questions too. My first question is, let us say if we have same aggregate source, okay, will the value of bulk specific gravity be same for three different mixes? Let us say using the same source, I am trying to do a mix design for bituminous concrete, for DBM and for SMB. So will the value of GSB or the bulk specific gravity, will it be same for all the three mixes? The answer is no. The specific gravity is aggregate gradation. My next question is that if the specific gravity of coarse aggregate, which is the material passing retained on 4.75 sieve, is, let us say, specific gravity 1, SG suffix 1, and the specific gravity of fine aggregate, which are material passing 4.75 sieve, is SG suffix 2, what will be the specific gravity of the mix if we are taking 60% of the coarse aggregate and 40% of the fine? Now, many a times, what I have seen, that people come with this particular answer. They take the arithmetic mean and they say that if I take 0.6 of SG1 plus 0.4 of SG2, I will get the specific gravity of the combined blend. Now, this is actually the wrong approach. Okay. So we have to take actually the harmonic mean to get the average. Now, why harmonic mean? Because the criteria which we are averaging here, it involves a ratio, it is mass by volume. Okay. Therefore, harmonic mean is a better accurate representation of the average rather than the arithmetic. So this is a very critical mistake which people make while doing the mixed design. Now comes the last part in the calculation. We have three stockpiles, A, B, and C. Let us say A has 60% coarse aggregate and 40% fine aggregate. B has 20% coarse aggregate and 80% fine aggregate, while C has 100% fine aggregate. If A, B, C are to be mixed at 40, 30, and 30% in combination, what is the final specific gravity? Now, to get the final specific gravity of the mix, we have to perform two harmonic mean calculations. Two times we have to take harmonic mean. First, for the individual stockpiles, we have to find the average specific gravity of the stockpile A, stockpile B, stockpile C by taking these harmonic means of individual stockpiles. Then we have to take the harmonic mean of the entire blend on the proportion we are using in the final system. That is 40, 30, and 30. Okay. So this is how we complete, or we actually calculate the bulk specific gravity of the aggregates. Okay, so with this we complete our discussion on the aggregates. Now what we will do after doing the aggregate test, and after doing the gradation, we will see that, does the aggregate satisfy the gradation and physical property requirements. Obviously, if it does not, we have to change the stockpile. If it does, we proceed. Now the question is, how important the aggregates, how important are aggregates, their properties in the final mix? It is very, very important. The role of aggregate in rutting is extremely high, as it is the main load carrying component and it provides internal friction to the mix. With respect to fatigue, it is moderate to high, while its role in low temperature cracking is moderate. Okay. Now we have to understand that aggregate occupies almost 80 to 85% of the volume of the total mix. We have to be very careful when we are selecting the type of aggregate, especially its shape and the angularity. It has direct relation with the performance. Also, correct estimation of specific gravity, as I discussed previously, is very critical to the success of the good mix design. So that's all on aggregates for now. Now let us mix the aggregates and bitumen and see the final mix. Okay. So before we can mix the aggregates and the binder, we have to know that at what temperature should they be mixed, at what temperature they should be blended, at what temperature should they be placed and compacted. Answer this question, we actually have to perform a rotational viscometer test. Now this is again one of the most underrated tests which I have seen in India with my limited experience. Anyways, so the mixing and compaction temperature is a function of the viscosity of the bitumen, okay, which is considered as the main component which is providing workability to the mix. So the mixing temperature range should be chosen corresponding to a viscosity of 0.17 plus minus 0.002 Pascal seconds, whereas the compaction temperature window is corresponding to the viscosity of 0.28 plus minus 0.03 Pascal seconds. Now, why this temperature is so important? Why are we concerned about the mixing and compaction? So what happens that if we overheat the binder, it may lead to premature aging and can result in fatigue cracking. On the other hand, if the temperature is less, which is underheating, then we won't get sufficient workability, and this can result in improper coating of the bitumen over the aggregates, which can cause moisture damage. Now, in low compaction temperature, if we are compacting at a lower temperature, it may lead to higher air voids due to improper compaction. This will cause aging, moisture damage, and also fatigue cracking. Okay. Hence, it is important that appropriate mixing and compaction temperature has to be maintained during the construction. Now, I will take a pause here and like to take back our discussion, because you know we are also parallelly discussing about warm mixes part. Now, how to find the mixing and compaction temperature of warm mix S1? Do we use a rotational viscometer? Actually, no. The use of rotational viscometer won't work with warm mix S1 because the mechanism which is involved in improving the workability by use of warm mix S1 is different depending on the technology we are using. Okay. So, this is just an overview that we have three different technologies. Foaming technology, we have organic additives and chemical additives. So foaming technology, most of the time we add the foaming agents or the water bearing agents, for example zeolite, we add it directly in the mix, okay, directly while the preparation. So what happens, that zeolite will break, water will come out, it will temporarily expand the volume of the bitumen, because this cold water, when it comes in contact with hot bitumen, a foam is created and it coats the aggregate and improves the working. How does organic additive works? They are waxes basically. They will melt after a particular temperature and they will reduce the viscosity of the binder. And below that particular temperature, the waxes will crystallize and they will regain the strength. When it comes to chemical agents, they basically function by reducing the frictional forces between the aggregate and the bitumen. Okay. A very different mechanism. So typically we use surfactants and soap like materials when it comes to chemical agents. Now these mechanisms, we will not be able to capture these mechanisms just by doing a rotational viscometer test. So there are various researches which are going on how efficiently we can determine the mixing and compaction temperature of WMA. Typically in India, we go with manufacturer's recommendation. Whatever the manufacturer of the additive says, we adopt it. But you know, parallelly research are going on, and our lab has also done some studies on finding out appropriate method for determining the mixing and compaction temperature. And you can refer to one of our recently published papers, which is basically on the development of this methodology, where we have developed a workability apparatus. We have validated our results using coating ability test and compaction test. And these are the two most important figures from the research work. Okay, which says, because we have used wax additives, we have used chemical agents, we have also used a foaming technology, and we have presented the extent of reduction of production temperatures using both these technologies. So you can have a look at the paper when you get time and try to understand more on and explore more on the procedure for finding out the mixing and compaction temperature for warm excess fluid. Okay. Now let us go back to our discussion on mixed design process. Now, once the binder and aggregates have been mixed, there are two important laboratory measurements to be made. One measurement has to be made on loose mixture, and the other measurement has to be made on the compacted mixture. Now, for the loose mix, we have to measure something which is called as the GMA, theoretical maximum specific gravity. What is theoretical maximum specific gravity? It is the ratio of the weight of the mix to the voidless volume of the mix. We also call this test as rise specific gravity. On the other hand, for the compacted mix, we have to evaluate the GMB, which is also called as the bulk specific gravity of the mix. What is the definition? It is the ratio of the weight of the mix to the compacted volume of the mix, which also includes the interparticle voids. So what is the difference between GMB and GMM? The difference is that in GMM, we are considering interparticle voids, whereas in GMM, we are not. We are only taking the volume of the aggregates and the volume of the binder. Now you have to remember here that GMB and GMM are properties of the mix. Okay, so they depend on the volumetric properties. But the specific gravity of the aggregates, which we discussed previously, the apparent specific gravity, bulk specific gravity, and effective specific gravity, they are the properties of the aggregates, and they will not change depending on the binder or the air voids in the mix. There are always doubts about these differences, so it's important to point them out. Now, here one more important aspect with relation to mix design, which I always tell, at least in my lab, to my students, that when you are doing GMM, what typically is done, that people prepare the bituminous mixture and they directly take the mix after cooling. They directly take the mix to do the GMM test. So this can sometimes give you a wrong value. What you can do after mixing this aggregate and bitumen, you condition the mix for 2 hours at the compaction temperature. At the compaction temperature, you put it in the oven for 2 hours. Now, why this is important? Because the aggregate, the bitumen, takes some time to get absorbed inside the aggregate pores. Okay. And if we see the GMM versus conditioning time, suppose this is the conditioning time, you will see that the GMM stabilizes only after a particular period of time. And there is a tendency that initially the GMM increases, because more bitumen is getting absorbed inside the mix. Okay, that is why it is very important to do this conditioning. Sometimes when we go for performance based mix design, we also do additional conditioning to replicate the short term aging and long term aging. How do we do that? For short term aging, we do it for 4 hours at 135 degrees Celsius, so that we can replicate the short term aging which is happening in the mixing plant. And on the compacted mix, we can put it in the oven at 85 degrees Celsius for almost 120 hours to replicate the long-term aging. But definitely these two criteria is not for the conventional mix design, and this can be adopted only when we are interested to see performance of mix. But for conventional mix design, this step should definitely be adopted before we measure the GMM of the sample. Here, again, one important thing, especially about GMD, is that what we typically do, we take the weight in here, we take the saturated surface dry weight, and we do some calculations. But if your mix has more number of pores, greater than 2% of pores on the surface, for example, typically what we get for OGFC or for stone metric asphalt, then this simple weight in air and weight in water won't work. So you have to do a paraffin coating. You have to do a paraffin coating and then measure the bulk specific gravity. So these are very small things which are missed out by students while they are performing experiments in the laboratory, but these are very important aspects. Okay. So let us now move ahead. Now we are ready with the prepared mix and have measured all the volumetric parameters required in the mix design. What are these parameters? GSB, GMM, and GMB. So these are the parameters. We have also chosen the design aggregate gradation. We have also chosen the design aggregate gradation for our mix design. The next step now is to calculate additional volumetric parameters using the measured parameters. So we will use these parameters to calculate additional parameters. What are those additional parameters? They are air voids, voids in mineral aggregates, voids filled with bitumen, effective specific gravity of aggregates, and the percentage of absorbed. Okay. Also, using the design aggregate gradation, the compacted Marshall specimen, we will measure the Marshall stability, flow, and tensile strength ratio. Okay. So, Marshall stability and flow, they are measured using the Marshall stability machine, which you all must have seen. Okay, by loading the specimen using a semicircular plate along the diametric plane. Typically, the hammer, we use an impact compaction. The hammer is 44 kg in weight with a 25.4 mm height of fall, and the sample dia is around 101.6 mm. We also perform modified Marshall test in case the nominal maximum aggregate size is more than 37.5 mm. In that case, the hammer weight goes to 10.2 kg and we use a 150 mm dia sample. Okay. So the test is done at 60 degrees Celsius at a loading rate of 51 mm per minute. The load at failure, so we will start this machine. This load will keep on increasing at a rate of 51 mm per minute. So the load at failure and the displacement of the specimen, they are defined as Marshall stability and flow. Additionally, we also perform indirect tensile strength test on dry and moisture conditioned specimen to check the moisture susceptibility of the mix. Now the ITS, or the indirect tension strength of the dry and wet condition, they are carried out at ambient temperature. Okay. As I said that in the presentation, I'm not going to discuss about the detail of the test methods that you can look later. Let us only focus on the fundamental concepts. Okay, now let us understand the definition and importance of the calculated parameters. Okay, now let us see the calculated parameters. Say this is the compacted mix. So if we draw the phase diagram of the mix, we will have the bulk volume of the aggregates. Bitumen, a part of which is inside the bulk volume of the aggregates. In other words, a part of bitumen will be absorbed in the aggregate pores, and we will have air voids. Okay. You see, these are the things. Now, having understood this, let us see the definition of voids in mineral aggregates. Definition of voids in. So what is voids in mineral aggregate? It is the amount of voids created by the aggregate skeleton. You see, which is marked by red arrow in the phase diagram. Now, higher the value of VMA, we have more space for the bitumen, is not it? For example, in stone metric asphalt, the VMA is around 18 to 20%. In comparison to a bituminous concrete, where the VMA is around 12 to 14% only. So for a fixed air void, let us say we are fixing the air void to 4%, we will get much higher optimum binder content in the SMA in comparison to bituminous concrete. Okay. Therefore, typically, you know, in SMA, the optimum binder content is around 6 to 6.5%, while the optimum binder content in bituminous concrete is around 5 to 5.5%. So as I said, that the red line in the phase diagram indicates the VMA of the mix. It is expressed, if you see this expression, it is expressed as percentage of the total bitumen. Now the calculation is done with the help of measured parameters. Now this is the basic definition. Now, but we cannot use this value for calculating because I don't know what is VV, what is VEP. So what we do, we convert this in terms of specific gravity, and this is the formula. In this formula, GMB we already know it is the bulk specific gravity of the mix. GSB is the bulk specific gravity of the aggregates, and PB it is the percentage of binder in the mix. Now you know, in my classes which I take during my course on pavement materials, I always ask the students to derive the formula rather than memorizing. You don't have to memorize this formula actually. This can be very easily derived using this definition and few simple steps. But definitely we have time constraint today, and it will be really tedious and boring for the participants to look into the derivation. So I am not considering the derivation part. But I always recommend the students that you please derive these expressions rather than remembering it or memorizing them. Okay. Next is the air voids. What is air voids? It is the available voids in the mix expressed as percentage of the total volume. Okay. This is shown by the red line in the phase diagram, and the formula is also shown. Okay. Now, what is voids filled with bitumen, VFB? As the name suggests, it is the volume occupied by the effective bitumen within the VMA. Okay, and this is shown by this particular arrow which you see. Okay, and this is how we calculate. Now, again, all these formulas which I'm showing here, they can be derived easily, and I recommend that you go back and do the derivation, and you don't have to memorize this formula. Now, using all the measured and calculated parameters which we have discussed till now, we can calculate the effective specific gravity of the aggregates and also the percentage of the absorbed. Now, you know, interestingly, all the efforts on measurement and calculation we have done, we have discussed, they were done to assess actually the effective specific gravity. So tomorrow in the future, you know, if we can find a method to measure the bitumen absorption in the lab, rather than calculating it indirectly, the whole mix design process can be very, very simple. We don't have to indulge in so many calculations involved in the mix design. Okay. Now, at this stage, we have to understand the importance of the calculated parameters also. Okay. So let us first begin with discussing about the importance of VM, voids in mineral aggregate. Now, voids in mineral aggregate is the most difficult mix design property to control. Though it is a very, very important parameter, but again, it is underrated too. People do not pay much attention on VMA, though it is a very, very important parameter. Correct use of VMA, correct optimization of VMA can actually produce long-lasting bituminous mixtures. Okay. So as we have already discussed, what does VMA do? It provides space for bitumen. So we need to have a minimum VMA so that sufficient bitumen can be incorporated. Okay. We need to have a VMA so that sufficient bitumen can be incorporated, and we still should have space for air voids. Now the requirement of minimum VMA, it is actually a function of the nominal maximum aggregate size. So VMA minimum is actually a function of nominal maximum aggregate size. This graph which you see here, it shows the change in VMA with increase in binder content. You can see it has a flattened U shape. What does it indicate? It indicates that the VMA is not very sensitive to the change in binder content. Okay, VMA is not very highly dependent on the change in binder content. Okay, and this horizontal line which I have shown here, this shows the minimum VMA required for any particular given mix. Okay. So our mix should actually be above this line. If we get the VMA just like curve 2, for example, we are getting a VMA just like curve 2, which coincides with the minimum VMA line, we have to change the job mix for them. Okay, so these are some very important checks which we ignore during the mix design. Okay, now even if the in the desirable curve, because you see this is a very long curve in changing binder content, we have to choose the optimum binder content. If we choose the optimum binder content on the wet size of the minimum, let us say if this is the minimum line and we are having a binder content somewhere on this side, then this can lead to bleeding on routing. Okay, so it's always good to choose the binder content, optimum binder content, very close to the minimum and a little on the drier side. Okay, okay. So, you know, while discussing this, out of various factors which affect VMA, the role of aggregate gradation and compactive effort is the main. Okay, the major role is of the aggregate gradation and compactive effort. We have to understand that the compactive effort is chosen to represent the traffic after several years. So the compactive effort to be given in the lab should replicate the density due to the predicted traffic in the field. Okay, a wrong compactive effort can lead to incorrect mix design and failure of the mix. How to understand this? How to understand the role of compaction in the lab? Let us take this particular picture. Okay, say we have designed our mix using 50 blows of Marshall compaction. Let us say we designed our mix using 50 blows of Marshall compaction in the lab, and we are assuming that the traffic which is going to come in the field will be low. Okay. The binder content, if you see that we are choosing the binder content corresponding to the minimum. Okay, see, the binder content was chosen on the dry side of the VMA curve, but let us say that the actual traffic was high. Though we predicted the traffic to be low, but the actual traffic was high. So though we designed with respect to the second curve, we actually are in the first curve. Though we designed with 50 blows, but our mix is being subjected to a compaction at the level of 75 blows in the field. Okay. So if we just transfer this line here, this brings on the wet side of the curve. Okay. So you can see that this is on the wet side of the minimum, and this will result in bleeding and rutting in the field. If we take another example, let us say we designed our mix in the lab considering that the field traffic will be very high. So we used 75 blows compaction on the Marshall mix. Okay. And we calculated the optimum binder content corresponding to 4% air void. Okay. Corresponding to 4% air void, we calculated the optimum binder content. But if the desired traffic, if the traffic which is actually coming on the pavement is less, then we actually land up in the second curve. And corresponding to that optimum binder content which we have selected, we get much higher air voids. Okay. So this may cause aging, moisture damage, and also rutting in the field. Okay. So you have to remember that the VMA criteria that will not change with changing compaction level. Therefore, for the anticipated traffic level and the gradation and the binder content should be, the gradation and binder content should be changed to suffice the compaction. Okay. So thus the compaction effort should be chosen judiciously to simulate the future traffic. This highlights the importance of the VMA. Okay. But definitely prediction of VMA is though an interesting topic, is a very complicated topic too. And you can refer to the Bailey's method, a very famous method called as Bailey's method, which describes the process of optimizing the aggregate prediction. So you can go back and look into this particular method. This table which you are seeing gives the number of blows for different traffic levels as specified by MS2. This is by MS2. Okay. Now you see the Marshall method, as we have seen, the history of the development of mix design was developed around 1930s. Okay, during that period, in highways were not traffic in the highways were not very high, and this compaction method actually worked during that time. But today we are receiving very high amount of traffic of the order of around 100 million standard axle, and the pavement is subjected to much higher energy. So an immediate question is that, is the impact compaction or giving 75 blows of compaction, is it sufficient, or we have to rethink about it? Because you see the super pave method, if you compare the energy supplied by the super pave gyratory compactor for the same mix, the super pave gyratory compactor provides much higher energy in compaction in comparison to the Martian mix. Okay, so probably we have to think is in this direction that how better we can take into consideration the future increase in traffic in the mix design. Okay, let's move ahead. The next critical parameter is the airway, which is considered in the mix design. Okay, so actually we design our mix for the target air void of around 3 to 5%. Now we have to remember that this air void is achievable after years of traffic and not after the placement. At the placement, during just after the construction, the air voids are kept in the range of around 6 to 8% typically. I hope most of you already know this. Okay. So controlling or maintaining air void is very important. If the air void drops down to a very low value, if less than 2%, this may lead to rutting and shoving in the mix. And if the air voids are kept very high, then it may be detrimental to the fertile life. Thus, maintaining the optimized range is very, very important. Now, VFP is sometimes very less understood. What is the importance of VFP? Because VFP is actually derived direct from VMA and air void. So if you see the formula of VFP, this is VMA minus air void divided by VFP into 100. So what is the importance? This can help, this parameter can prevent the mix from having too high or too low binder content. How is it possible? Say we have a mix to be designed at 4% air void, and the VMA of the mix which we calculated is 18%, and the minimum VMA was 12%. So definitely we are satisfying the minimum VMA criteria. Okay, but the calculated VFP is 78%. Okay, so if I do not calculate VFP, one may think that the mix design is fine because 18% is obviously higher than 12%. But since the VFP is very high, this will indicate that the mix will have a tendency to show bleeding. Okay, that is why we keep the VFP in a particular range of around 65 to 75%. Okay. Now, with this, let us proceed to the next step. Okay. So these are the typical takeaways. To produce a mix, select an aggregate gradation and binder content, which when subjected to compaction for years of by traffic should yield a mix of 4% air void. Aggregate gradation and binder content should be selected based on the anticipated traffic, and the compaction level in the laboratory should be chosen accordingly. So these are two important takeaways from our discussion on VFP. Okay. Now, what are the further steps? Now, once we have evaluated all the parameters using, including conducting the test of Martian stability and flow, we need to plot the variation with change in binder content. This slide, it shows various graphs, including change in stability with binder content. You can see here, change in flow with binder content, change in unit weight with binder content, change in voids filled with asphalt with binder content, air voids with binder content, and VMA with binder content. Okay, so we have to plot all these graphs. So using the curve of air void versus binder content, first we will determine the binder content corresponding to 4% air void. Let us say this is the 4% air void, and this is the this is the 4% air void. And corresponding to this, I am calculating the binder content. Okay. At this binder content, we will check if the limits of all the other parameters, are within the specified range. So let us say this is typically how much? 8%. So we will come here 4.8%. We will see whether this is more than the minimum VMA required. We will come here. We will see if this is in the range of 65 to 75%. We will come here. We will see what is the flow for typically 2 to 4 mm in our case. We will come here. We will see minimum stability 9 kN or not, and so on. Okay. So using first, we will take the binder content corresponding to 4% error mode, and then we will put a check to all the other parameters whether they fall within the limited range or not. Okay. So here, find the binder content corresponding to 4% error mode and check if all the parameters, stability, flow, VMA, and VFA, are within the permissible range. If it is not in the permissible range, we have to recheck the entire process. If it is within the permissible range, it is a green signal, we will move ahead. But there is another step which is left. What is that step? Check the moisture susceptibility using the tensile strength ratio. We have to perform the indirect tensile strength test in the wet condition and in the dry condition. And we will take this ratio multiplied by 100 to find out the tensile strength ratio. If this tensile strength ratio, and now this check is also sometimes, many a times not made in the laboratory, but this is an important part of the mechanism. If the TSR is greater than or equal to 80% as specified by the ministry, it should be greater than or equal to 80%. If it is not, which means the binder and aggregates are probably incompatible and we have to think of probably using an anti-stripping additive or using lime in the mixture. If it is greater than 80%, then we complete the mixture process. Okay. Now you have to remember here that fundamental properties are not directly measured in the mixture. Okay. Asphalt content is being selected on the basis of a measured parameter that best controls the pavement performance. Over a period of time, after considerable research, people have found that this parameter is airworthy. That is why we determine the optimum binder content corresponding to the air void, and volumetric have historically provided, you know, a very good indication of mixture's probable performance during its service. But again, these exercises which we do, they are in no way related to the direct fundamental performance. What are these performance? We want our mix to be rut resistant. We want our mix to be moisture resistant. We want our mix to be fatigue resistant. But these fatigue resistance, rut resistance, moisture resistance, okay, we are measuring, but rut resistance and fatigue resistance, we are not actually measuring in the lab while doing the mix design. Now, this entire procedure, it worked well till we were using the viscosity graded binders and the loading in the highways were limited. But what is happening now, we are receiving very high loading in the highways. We are also using different types of binder. We are using polymer modified binder. We are using crumb rubber modified binder. We are using warm mix additives. And there are so many new materials which has come up. Now, with these new materials, it has been found that air voids alone, the volumetric parameters alone, are not sufficient to judge the performance of the mix. Okay, are not sufficient. That is why there is a tendency of or driving the research to move towards performance-based mix design. Now, one of my students at IIT BHU, she is actually working on performance-based mix design through an NHRA-funded project. And we are trying to develop specifications. We are also trying to follow the specifications by other international agencies, because this is a very new area. People around the globe in different countries, different states in US, they have just started using performance-based mix design in some of their projects. So we have to think rationally on how to, you know, develop this performance-based mix design. Now, sometimes students are always curious to understand that we hear so much about performance-based mix design, but what actually is a performance-based mix design? I mean, what are the steps? How do we think about a performance-based mix design? So just before concluding, you know, I thought of putting a particular slide. Let me quickly go through this. I will come back to the conclusions. So this is a slide which is a thought process, basically, not a standard process, but a thought process on how we have to think on developing the performance-based mix design. Let us say I want to develop a mix which this rut resistance. Okay, so after the completion of the mix design, I should be confidently able to say that this mix will be rut resistant in the field, and after let us say 1 year of traffic or 2 year of traffic, you will not observe any rut in this particular mix. How do I confidently say that? So let us say we are taking an aggregate gradation and an asphalt binder, and let us say we have four different mixes. Okay, four different mixes are taken. We will have some lab produced mix, the one which we are preparing using Marshall method. We will also have a plant produced mix, okay, the one mix which is prepared at the mixing plant. This plant produced mix is going to be ready in the field, because after preparing the plant, it is taken by trucks to the field and there it is compacted. So the plant produced mix is laid in the field. Let us say, since we have four different mixes, these four different mixes are being laid at four different locations in India, and let us say these locations have same environmental conditions with some maximum. Let us say all the four locations are in the northern part of the India, and they receive an approximately 60 degrees Celsius maximum pavement temperature. Okay, so I have laid four different mixes A, B, and C at four locations in India, in northern part of India. Say, okay. Now, coming to the lab produced mix and the plant produced mix, I will collect the mix from the plant also, and definitely I am producing the mix in the field also using the same materials. So I will compact after conducting short-term aging. Why short-term aging? Because rutting is a phenomena which will happen only after short-term aging. So I will make compacted specimen after short-term aging my mixes. Okay. What I will do? I will do a performance test. Now the question is, which performance test? There are so many performance tests available only for rutting. Do I need to do a dynamic creep test, an Hamburg wheel rut test, a simple wheel rut test, or what kind of test do I need? You can choose any test when you are developing. Let us say we are choosing Hamburg wheel rut test. Why Hamburg wheel rut test? Because it gives a better simulation of the movement of traffic in the pavement. Okay, so we are choosing, say, Hamburg wheel rut test, and we are conducting a wheel rut test, let us say at a particular temperature. Let us say we have taken 60 degrees Celsius, assuming that this is the maximum temperature for the tropical climate we have in India. You can take any other temperature. You can take 70 degrees Celsius you want, 80 degrees Celsius or you want. Choose. Make a rational choice here. Okay. Now, these four mixes I have prepared in the lab and I have conducted wheel rut test. Now, I will quantify the performance of all the four mixes. How? By using some parameters. Let us say I am measuring the run depth after 10,000 Ludwig cycles. That can be a parameter. Or we are, let us say, measuring number of load cycle till a rut depth of 10 mm is observed in the particular mix. So any of this can be selected. You can use your own performance parameter, but select one. Okay, let us say I am selecting rut depth in mm after 10,000. So after 10,000 loading cycle, I will stop the test, and in all the four mixes I will measure that these four mixes A, B, and C, what is the rut depth in these mixes. Okay, the question is the performance of the lab and the plant compacted mixes same? Ideally they should be same, because we are using the same material, but sometimes because of variability in the plant and in the lab, more controlled environment in the lab, the performance may not be same. Okay, the rut depth may not be same. So establish a relationship between the rut depth you get in the plant and the rut depth you get in the lab for the same mix. For example, X mm of rut depth in the plant means Y mm of rut depth of lab mixes. This you do for your own sample and keep it ready. Then I have laid at four different location. Okay. Now I'm observing the performance of this pavement for subsequent period of time, maybe for 6 months, maybe for a year, because I'm expecting that rutting in the bituminous mix, if any, will occur only after the initial stages. It is not a long-term phenomenon. It is a short-term phenomenon, rutting in the bituminous mixture. So I'm observing my pavement, let us say for 6 months, for a year, and I'm measuring the rut depth after some Z number of standard epsilon load deviation. Let us say after 20,000 standard epsilon load reputation, I am going to all these four places and measuring the rut depth in these particular mixes, the four mixes. Okay. Now I am comparing the rut depth for these four mixes which I got in the lab with the rut depth of the mixes which I got in the field. Okay, and based on these observation, based on this comparison, I am actually establishing my limits in the lab. Okay. For example, location A and B performed well and showed a run depth of 3 mm after Z number of standard axle load repetition. Location C and D showed poor performance with 12 mm run depth after same Z number of standard axle load repetition. Now I am seeing what were the lab results for the mixes A, B, C and D. Okay. What should be the limits for mix design? It can happen. Let us say one example is after 10,000 load cycle repetition, if the rut depth in the lab is less than 5 mm, our mix will perform well. So what is my standard I am developing? You conduct a Hamburg wheel load tester using a specified procedure which I am telling you. Do 10,000 load repetition in the Hamburg wheel load tester, check the rut depth. If the rut depth of your mix is less than 5 mm, I assure that your mix will not have any rutting when it is laid in the field. Okay, so this is called as performance mix. Now it is not necessary that that mix will have 4% air void, minimum 13% VMA. It can have a little deviation in the, or we can be more flexible with the volumetrics. Definitely not very flexible, because volumetrics are good indicators of performance, but we can be a little flexible. Okay, we need not be very stringent with 4% air void, with X percentage of binder content, with Y percentage of VMA and so on. Likewise, you can also think on how performance model for fatigue can be developed. Okay, so or a performance based mix design for fatigue can be developed. So this is just an idea, and I thank my student Sadia for preparing this particular slide for me. Because this was done in a little hurry, and I think it is in an okay condition. I'm not sure, but I thank her for that. Okay, coming back to the key takeaways from today's lecture, we have learned that binder plays an important role in governing the performance of the mix, and rheological testings are more important in comparison to the empirical tests we currently perform in India. As I have highlighted, I have stressed upon that specific gravity is a very important parameter. So correct estimation of specific gravity is one of the keys for successful volumetric calculation. Another important aspect in the Marshall mix design, also we have to adopt something which is called as design aggregate gradation, so that we can optimize the our choice of material and material properties, okay, and suitable aggregate gradation. VMA is a very critical parameter which is not paid much attention currently, but if we can control the VMA, we can control it, we can indirectly control the performance of the mix also. Okay, definitely air void has been a prime indicator of performance. So too high or too low air void content can lead to failure in the mixture. And finally, all the testings which we currently do as a part of the mix design, they are not direct replica of the performance of rutting and fatigue cracking. So performance based mix design is the need of the hour. With this, I have one more information to give specifically for this presentation. Most of the contents were taken from MS2, so I acknowledge the same, and images were taken from Pavement Interactive, research articles and other sources of Google Images platform.